Welcome to Studio 1430, a Norwegian talk show filled with stars from the underground. Real music, real people, and real stories. Enjoy the cut! Today's guest in Studio 1430 is the band Den Saakaldte. Welcome, guys.
Thanks. Thank you.
Can you please introduce yourself and tell me what role in the band you got?
Yes, I'm Storm. I'm the current singer.
Sickly guitars.
Yes, and you are a new member, Storm.
Yeah.
How is it to sing in a band that already got a name?
How it is to sing in a band that already has a reputation that sort of precedes it, correct?
Mm-hmm.
There is a lot of hard work to it. You need to get the gist of what the band is about, what the lyrics is about, what you are representing, and how you are to kind of feel the music, if you will, and feel the lyrics, because you got to get into it. If you're not into it, you're faking it, and it's about really being honest about the music. So it's not easy, but that's sort of the good thing about it as well, because it requires that discipline and that hard work to really get into it, to find your voice in something that already has had a voice.
Great, but what do you do about the Swedish lyrics?
The Swedish lyrics? I don't think we have played the Swedish, the songs that are in Swedish until now, so that haven't been a problem.
Okay.
No, that's quite true. We haven't performed the two songs from the first two releases that Nicholas had written in Swedish, so it hasn't been a problem.
Okay.
I don't think it will be any problem anyway, because let's say it wasn't a problem for Nicholas being Swedish, singing Norwegian, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's gonna be a problem for us and for Storm performing this with, you know, Norwegian mentality, Norwegian style.
Mm. All right. Yeah, but when we talk about Nicholas, can you tell why did he quit the band, and how was it to get a new frontman after he decided to leave?
Well, the thing is that when Nicholas joined Den Saakaldte, he was living in Norway, so it was way easier for us to do things together, right? To jump into a studio room and record stuff. At the same time, Nicholas moved back to Sweden, Shining became way more active compared to all the previous years, rehearsing and touring all the time and recording new material based on being more professional, right? Record label, and it's good for them, they put a lot of money back to it, and it's quite understandable that he wants to put all the time and effort in something that it's not just how to put it. Den Saakaldte is something for us to feel better as persons. It's like let's say our doctor during our free time. For Nicholas, Shining is more than that. It's like a profession. So I don't, you know, there hasn't been any bad blood between us. We're still friends, and we still respect each other, and it was totally understandable that he had to do it.
Yeah. That's great to hear. But I read that you got a second vocalist, Eivind Hægeland. Is that correct?
Eivind, Eivind, he's been vocalist for Spiral Architect and Arcturus during the rebirth of Arcturus. He's a very talented artist, very good friend. The only reason that he didn't go more than just the recording of one song for a split EP with Horna we did from Finland was because Eivind, he lives in south of Norway. He lives in Finland, so it's quite far away from the center of the activities we have, which is Oslo. So it just couldn't go because of logistics, basically.
So now all the band members live in Oslo at the
Apart
moment.
from me, I live in Notodden.
Notodden. How far from Oslo is that?
I would say it's like 2 hours.
Okay,
Far enough.
far
Two hours,
enough.
I would
Yeah.
say.
But how often do you rehearse as a full band?
Now that is changing right now because we've kind of been stuck without a rehearsal space for a while. That's changed now, that's in changing now. But in the time I've been in Saakaldte, we've rehearsed not that often, but before gigs, kind of just to get the cyst right and get the songs down and just make sure it's all there.
During the time with Nicholas, we were rehearsing like 2 times a year.
Okay.
To put it simple, rehearsing every week for me personally is a bit of a drag. I don't really. As long as it's stimulating to make something new, I think it's interesting. But rehearsing just in order to rehearse, I think it's a pointless thing.
Yeah. Okay.
The band doesn't really need it at this point, playing the old songs.
You know your songs.
How it's supposed to be. And whenever we're writing new stuff, that needs to be rehearsed in, but that's not something you don't have to spend 36 hours a week in a rehearsal space playing songs that you already know. Especially with many of the members already having played together for so many years, they know each other in and out.
I guess the only point is basically for T-Bot to keep in shape in regards to drumming and nothing more than that. But the good thing is that T-Bot, he's also a member of other bands. He plays with Third Attempt, for example. So if we're not gonna rehearse for 2 months or 3 months, we know that he's gonna rehearse with them. So it's not like he's gonna be a blob or something.
No. He keeps the drumming in yeah. Okay, great. I think that people who don't know you, they read or listen they hear that you are maybe a true Norwegian black metal band. You kind of fit that term, I think. But you are from Spain, is that correct?
No, I'm actually from Hellas.
Hellas.
But I don't think that Den Saakaldte has ever been true Norwegian black metal.
No.
We're far away from that.
Okay.
How can you be true Norwegian black metal with jazz influences or blues influences in the music? It's impossible. We don't play this necro thing, Tokke or Urge Hall are into. Well, we have many similarities, of course, but it was never our aim to fit to that label. And there are so many different elements in our music that I would say it's the way it is right now, it's like doom thrust black, a weird mixture of that with elements from jazz and and blues, and nothing necro, nothing in the typical true Norwegian black metal style that other bands do and have been doing for many, many years.
No.
As a digression, it's it's really no point in trying to label yourself as a band anyway, sort of. I at least feel that Den Saakaldte is about truth, and we've had several conversations about this. It's about being yourself and uttering the things that you need to do, that you need to get out, and you're channeling it through music. And the way it turns out, that's Den Saakaldte. That's where the mastermind of Sykkylä and Kjalva, being the songwriters, really, really just aspires and kind of rises to the occasion.
Yes.
I think also when it comes to the lyrics, absolutely nothing in common with, for example, the bands mentioned earlier. Nothing necro around it. It's personal experiences and personal views in regards to dark aspects of mind, dark aspects of life,
yeah.
And Satanism in a completely different approach compared to other bands. We never, for example, say Kill for Satan.
No.
Personally, when it comes to me, Kill for Satan is a bit funny. And,
it's a little funny.
I don't think Satan ever asked for anyone to kill someone or hunt something. So, we have different approach in regards to Satanism and what Satan represents. Nothing in common.
No, but you got some pretty dark titles. Like the first record, Ölmörke och Depression. And like All Hail Pessimism and Fan I Helvete. It's
All Hail Pessimism is actually, no one should actually take it literally. It's in a way of sarcasm, and it came through a discussion I've been having with Sideman, the bass player in previously,
yeah.
In Den Saakaldte, where we were actually discussing in regards to life and things happening that we see around us, that things are going wrong, and people, just because we're realists and we state the problem and we say, okay, this is wrong, this shouldn't be like this, so we're just stating the obvious that there is a problem and not hide behind our finger, right? Pretending that it's not there. It is there. We see it. And for some people, this is being a pessimist, right? For us, it's not pessimism, it's realism. And that was, in a way, self-sarcasm, saying all hail pessimism. It's exactly in the same sense that Catatonia, for example, said viva emptiness. I don't think they really enjoy, you know, the feeling of emptiness, but they're so sarcastic about it. But it is how it is, right? So that in regards to all hail pessimism, when it comes to Ölmörke, it's again stating the obvious. Ölmörke was composed and written 90%, I would say, music-wise and lyric-wise, by me. And it reflects to, I would say, the worst period of my life. And nothing theatrical around it, nothing poetic around it. It was just a shit period that I just had to write down and get done with. And Ölmörke, even if it sounds even if it sounds destructive and maybe in a sense that it passes the message of complete destruction and annihilation in the end of the album, there is also the message and the meaning of rising up again and not being there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really, you know, about annihilation. It's more about understanding the destruction, understanding the darkness, and then rising up again.
Hmm. And that record, I think I have read that you recorded it in a basement. Is that true?
That's very true. It wasn't recorded in the studio. The only thing recorded in the studio was Niklas's vocals, nothing more.
Okay. So all the instruments was recorded in a basement, in Norway, or in?
Well, drum parts were recorded in Stavanger, and the rest were recorded in Oslo.
Hmm. All right. Hmm. Can you tell me where did you get the interest for music when you was a youth and you heard? Why did you become a rock and roll fan, and yeah, black metal later maybe, and yeah, how did that start for you guys?
Well, I don't know where it started for you, secretly, but I think I got into AC/DC when I was rather old. I think I was 13 or something. And I just really loved the sound, and it's a, I mean, you're 13 years old, a lot of things are changing, and you gotta find your kind of niche and start like building your identity, building your personality. And it was just something. I think the first record I got was may have been Back in Black or Flick on the Switch. It just represented something more raw, something energetic, and I've never really been able to sit still for long periods of time. There's always something going on, there's always a lot of energy. So it represented something, something I could go along with. And then I discovered Metallica and Guns N' Roses, and really just went from there. And I think I was 16 or 17 when I got into Mayhem and Emperor and Keep of Galesin and stuff like that. And I figured, hey, why not try growling?
Mm.
And there it is.
Mm. And when did you start to play guitar and growl? And yeah, you said growling, but
I think I started playing guitar when I was 13.
Yeah,
so I'm not a guitarist. I've never really been a guitarist. I haven't been able to connect with that instrument as I'm connecting with my vocals. I can express myself, but when you're digging deep down into the vocal parts, when you're really starting to, you're growling something that is close. It is close to you emotionally. And it's something you've sat down, you've written the lyrics, you're satisfied with the lyrics, and then you start comparing it and start working it with the music. You're touching something within yourself. At least for me, it's the ultimate way of expressing myself.
Mm.
Or at least through music.
For me, when it comes to music, has been way different compared to the Storm, for example. I think I started with Kiss when I was 8, and evolved to heavy metal bands like Maiden and Scorpions back then, Manowar, lots of Manowar, and Halloween. There was a lot of German bands back then that I was into. Halloween and Creator and Destruction later on, Tankard. For some reason, Germany, I was more attracted to German metal compared to metal from the US, like Metallica or Slayer or things like that. Lots of King Crimson, Merciful Fate, and for me personally, everything changed in regards to music in 92. When I first listened to the demo of Beherit from Finland, that fried my brain in a way, and been in black metal since 92, it's something that fitted with my mentality as a person, and I was lucky enough also to grow up in a in an environment having amazing individuals around me. I was, and still am, good friends with the guys from Rotting Christ, the guys from Septic Flesh, Necromantia, all the pioneers of great black metal. And I was the youngest throughout the years of the 1990. Decade where everything evolved around this genre. It wasn't that big group of people involved in black metal, early black metal. I think in Athens, and Athens is like a city with 6 million people, right? I think we were like 200-250 maybe that were active in the scene as musicians or fans. I remember Samael played with Rotting Christ 1993, and I think there were like 200 people over there. And right now Rotting Christ are having sold out gigs with 1,500 people, right? So things have changed a lot.
Yeah. But how old were you when you moved to Norway?
I was 25,
okay.
26.
So you played in bands back in Hellas before that?
I've been playing since I was 13.
Yeah.
First black metal material I recorded I was 13.
All right. Well, is that available? It's still available?
I think the first things that I recorded, 17-inch came out last summer from a Greek label, and when it comes to my previous band that I had the main activities, first album was released in 98, I think. And I made like 4 or 5 releases with that man before starting with Den Saakaldte.
Great, but now you are covering great bands such as Slayer and Bathory. What are your relationship with these bands?
It's Slayer and Bathory. At least for me, Slayer was Slayer and Metallica was one of the earliest extreme bands that I got exposed to. I think it was the God Hates Us All album. That was my first encounter with Slayer, and I was like, wow, holy fuck, that guy is aggressive. And I've just always been attracted to that. And I have a profound respect for at least Slayer. I never really got that much into Bathory. It's always been one of those bands that, whenever I've heard it, it's so raw. It's so, there's something about it, but it's one of those bands I haven't listened that much to and enough.
Sometimes I forget how young keys. But for me, listening that someone got into Slayer with gut hits also, it's a bit funny. So,
yeah, because that is a...
I forget that he's so young. So I got into Slayer, the first thing I listened from Slayer was actually a live album, Decade of Aggression, 1990. And well, for me, Slayer is a big influence. At the same time, I can say that when it comes to tribute releases, I think I've done all the things I wanted to do. I've been part of a tribute to Celtic Frost with my previous band. Right now, Slayer and Bathory, and Bathory for me is one of the biggest influences when it comes to black metal, and not only black metal, but also the power metal, the epic albums of Bathory are a big influence, and it was something that at one point or another had to be done, and now it's done, and I'm feeling quite okay with it.
Are you done with the recording?
Yeah, everything is ready.
Okay. When will these two...
The Slayer tribute, I think it's been released in a couple of weeks.
5th of May.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think the Bathory either during the summer or early autumn.
Great. That's awesome. Okay, I'm thinking of your band name. I have read that it's from a song from the band Ved Buens Ende. Your t-shirt says yes. Why did you choose that band name?
I guess because apart from the fact that Ved Buens Ende has always been one of my favorite bands, when I listened to this song in particular, it made sense to me, like it was talking about me. That everything that had to do with lyrics or the vibes coming out from the music, that it was me. So I remember talking with Bikopnik back then, and I asked him, is it okay with you if I'm gonna use the title of the song as name for the band? And he's like, well, I'll be happy if you do so. So it came like that.
Okay. Great. Okay. I will talk a little about the recording process. How do you write music and how do you write lyrics? Can you say something about how you do it and where and stuff?
How? Specifically, what do you mean?
Like when you make music, I know that you don't rehearse together that much, but when you write music, is that alone at home with your guitar, or is it, you know, at a rehearsal space together with all the band?
That in regards to writing music, I would be alone with the others, I would freak out and feel suffocated. And I think most of the people involved in the Saakaldte, we are like that. We stay with the other people a bit more and don't, you know, what is within our limits, and then we start freak out with each other. So we operate, and I think things go way better if we have our peace of mind and being in a way isolated in order to do what we need to do. And with Diablo, for example, it has been since the day he joined the band, it has been cooperation through sending files to each other, like recording things to alone at home and sending stuff to each other and make a final result. Well, we're not that much into let's meet for beers and start playing music. It's for some people it works, but for us it doesn't. And I guess the same goes with lyrics. You can't write lyrics based on demand, right? To say, okay, we need to write about that. And
it's not something you do on a whim.
No.
It's
you need a trigger, you need a kicker. I can spend 8 hours in at a cafe or at work or wherever, but it's if you're not emotionally and mentally there, if you don't have that core emotion that you're feeling right now, if you're going through a hard time, it's way easier because the words kind of make themselves, sort of. It always needs to be written and rewritten and reorganized, and you need to kind of channel what you are feeling and the way you are seeing yourself in a certain situation, or the way you are seeing a certain situation from that, from your point of view. You need to get it down. It's not something you can you can't run out, get shit-faced and party in a club or whatever, and then like sit, all of a sudden sit down and write some lyrics about I'm feeling depressed. It's not how it works.
Actually, for me it would work. I fucking hate going out.
Okay. That is a good point.
I would actually write amazing stuff if I would come back home after being out in the center. Way good.
So I need to force you to more out. Is that what you're saying?
The kicker, if you ask me.
Well, at least for the things I've written, I need the emotional state of mind, and I need a phrase that I can start working with. And when it works, it's usually done in 10 to 15 minutes, but you need to get there.
So when you are in that creative space, then it goes pretty fast.
Yeah.
Well, it all depends, right? I mean, and that is actually why I'm really grateful when it comes to a record label. The record label we signed, Agonia Records, because they were patient for 4 years and waiting from All Hail Pessimism to Funny Helvetia. They could easily say, okay, fuck this, you know, we cannot wait more. You should release the album, but at the same time, music and black metal in particular, it cannot be music based on demand. It has to be real, and if it's not real, then it's crap. I cannot say to him, for example, I need 4 songs, write me 4 lyrics for 4 songs within the next 1 week, because I know that it's gonna be bullshit. Right, and at the same time, there is acknowledgement both when it comes to music and lyrics that maybe someone is not gonna do anything at all for 6 days, and on the last 1 day, there's gonna be so much inspiration, so many feelings that need to be presented either on paper or on guitar, and be so creative that we're gonna write 4 or 5 songs in 1 day. So that's how it works. That's how music should be. It shouldn't be stress, if you see my point.
Okay, but the artwork for your albums, I saw that you made one of the covers.
Is that... No, I didn't make covers. I make layouts.
Layouts.
Yeah. Yeah. But the covers mainly are, and some of the layouts mainly are made by Trin and Kim.
Yeah.
With our good friends, and it's like, how should I put it? It's like blind trust, because I know what they're capable of. That have been working with bands like Ulver and Darkthrone and Mayhem, presenting amazing results. And I know that when I'm gonna assign them something, they're gonna come up with something of quality and that would fit and represent the music and the lyrics. So I think that the next album is also gonna be Trin and Kim doing everything around they got and artwork.
So it's Trin and Kim that have made artwork for all the albums you got?
Apart from Elmerk, yeah, and the Digibook re-release of All Hell Pessimism, it's been Trainman King working with.
Great. Okay. We talked a little about Ölmörke and Depression. You recorded that in a basement, but your other releases, where did you record those?
We usually record at Strand studio.
Where is that?
That's in Oslo.
Okay.
Marius, the guy behind Strand, he's really talented when it comes to engineering, and it's been quite easy going working there, so I think the next album is gonna be there as well.
Great. Which release are you most proud of from Den Saakaldte? Which is, if you can say, one is better than the other, so means more or something?
As I said, it's Den Saakaldte has to do with personal experiences, so I can't be more proud of one or the other, you know. It's all parts of myself. It's like saying I like my arm better compared to my leg, so I cannot say that. But I would say that the most powerful release in regards to feelings, that would be Ölmörke. Because it represents my darkest moments, I guess, my darkest period in life.
Okay, but kind of the same question again, but not exactly. For people who don't have heard any music from you before, can you say some songs they should start with if they are going to check you out? Which 3, 4, 5 songs should I start with?
That really depends what you're into, sort of, because the way I'm feeling it is every song sort of has a certain meaning, a certain feeling, a certain thing to it. If you're just like the average Joe just walking around liking blast beats and stuff, Fan I Helvete is a good record, because it has more... at least songs like Din Siste Dag is very, it's very aggressive. It's very, at least when I got into the band, that's one of the songs that I really kicked on because of the aggression inherent in the song. Then you got more emotional things from earlier back on.
One thing is for sure, if someone is looking for music to party with and go out and have a good time, then Saakaldte is not the right band. It's something people should listen home. It's let's say that it's music for thinking and taking decisions in life with, and not something to have a good time.
No, it's not a party music. No. Okay, we will talk a little about your live setting. Can you say how many concerts have you been playing with Den Saakaldte? Ish.
It's 3 at this point. We actually did 2 gigs in one night, like 3 weeks ago. That was funny. But yeah, it's 3. We did a concert at Good Omens in Trondheim. Then we played Pokalen. That was at the end of March. We played with Dødheimsgard and Gehenna, and later on we moved on to the second gig, where we played with bands like Ora Noir and don't remember the other bands. I think one of them was Enter Obscurity or something. Yeah. So it's three.
Okay, great. But do you soon are going to play in Oslo again?
No.
No.
No point.
No point.
We played one gig 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. It's,
so you wait a year or something?
It's, it's better to present what you want to say and what you want to take out to people that... not are ready and open-minded to get everything you give, right? Playing for the same people that you delivered like 3 weeks ago. It's no point.
But for the audience, maybe it's a point. They, if they want to see
then
you,
they have to wait.
They have to wait.
Then they should have been there 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
It's a... it's way better to save interest both from our end and from their end and make something better that would please both sides after 1 year or 2 years or I don't like doing half things, you know.
No.
Why the hell I should do another gig doing exactly the same thing I did 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago. But it's way better to make a new album and present new songs after 1 year or 2 years.
But can you tell me, well, that to you, Sikili, what can you say is your best live experience with the band Den Saakaldte? Do you remember a show that was very good?
I would say for me, that would be Partisan in Germany in 2009 for many reasons. One of the reasons is Niklas vomiting on stage like a cat. I think it was a bit interesting. But yeah, the whole experience was really intense due to many different reasons. So.
Can you say some reasons?
It's... Let's put it like that. It's a way intense feeling playing in front of 10-15,000 people by having one rehearsal behind you.
Yeah, okay, great. But almost the same question. Can you say your worst live experience with the band? If you have ever had a gig that went wrong or something?
Many things go wrong in every gig. I don't have any... I don't have any regrets in things I've done. Because if I would have regrets in things I've done, it would be like disrespecting the people that were there, right? And as long as there is one person in the room being there because he shows respect and interest in what I'm doing and what I'm presenting, and that's fine for me. So no regrets.
No regrets. Nice. Can you tell some stories from the backstage area? Is it something that have happened behind the scenes that people don't know, that they maybe would like to know?
I think most likely in that sense we're the most boring band ever. Nothing... we're not the party people, to put it like that. I don't remember on Kjalva staying behind after a concert to drink or anything. He just goes to the hotel and sleeps.
Yeah, it's pretty it's pretty quick to do that.
I guess it has to do with when you have in the band members Kjalva, Seidemann, that have been playing with 1349 since the early days, right? All the crazy stuff they wanted to do, they've done this many, many years ago, and the same goes, I guess, for the same goes for V that has been playing with Nocturnal Breed. We're getting old. Last couple of days.
You're getting old.
I'm getting old. I'm old. So no, nothing that I would say would make other people happy.
It's not exactly Mötley Crüe. And then again, if you're not taking out all you got live, you are presenting something. You are by not giving your fullest when you're playing a gig. When if you're not committed to it on all levels, you're kind of stealing from the fans that paid money and invested in their time and energy to come there and enjoy the music. So it's usually, at least for me, I usually need like 5 minutes just laying down after a gig, because I'm taking it all out.
All the energy is...
It's just straight out of the window. And that's kind of the thing. I'm not gonna talk shit about bands that party after the gig, but then again...
Everyone can do whatever the hell they want to do.
Then again, you should maybe have used that little more of that energy on the stage, maybe. Or it's just me just being unexercised. I don't know.
Well, rock and roll is rock and roll, you know. Everyone should do whatever they feel like doing. But when it comes to Den Saakaldte, as music, we're not party music, right? So it would be a bit... shock, I guess, even for us, if we were so philosophical around what we do as a band and as what we represent as a band, and when off stage to be the party people, we're not that. So other people, of course, are that, and you know, there's nothing bad about it, and we're not gonna criticize anyone, but it's like that. They have the right to be like that, but at the same time, you know, no one should expect that we should be something different compared to what we are.
No. You said earlier that Den Saakaldte music is kind of supposed to be listened when you are alone and listened to, and listen carefully to the music. But when you play a gig, it is maybe thousands of people standing together and enjoying your music. What do you feel about that?
I think the really interesting thing with Den Saakaldte is that when we play, I barely see anyone, for example, headbanging. No. We're not the... I guess we're not the music that people would go crazy with, right? So I think it's really beautiful in a sense, seeing people with... being with closed eyes, just enjoying what they listen to and what they get from stage. And see people that are really focused in what they see on stage. And for me, that's the pleasing thing, doing a gig, that there is this connection, while at the same time having this connection, you also have, or at least I like to have, this wall in between the band and the audience. I don't think that Den Saakaldte is or should ever be the band that should be with hey, 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 and let me see your hands or things like that. I think it's silly.
But how would you react if the crowd started to like do a mosh pit or the wall of death stuff, and how
with Den Saakaldte.
Yes, how would you react if the audience started to jump around?
Most likely I would start laughing.
Yeah.
It doesn't fit.
No. But ha- doesn't fit. So it hasn't happened yet.
Luckily, no.
Great.
People are free to do whatever they want.
Yeah.
If that's the way you kind of want to enjoy music. I mean, it's quite common to mosh pit. I've seen mosh pit to pop bands, for God's sakes. So people are free to do whatever they want, but it's not kind of, it's not in the spirit of the band to kind of instigate.
Or provoke.
Or provoke.
Provoke, something like that.
No. Great. Do you have any special things on your rider? Something unusual?
Or I don't think we even have a rider.
So you get food, you get beer, you get wine, you get...
I guess the normal stuff.
Then, yeah.
We're not the band that is gonna ask for pink toilet paper.
No.
I got seedless grapes, but that's kinda... It's not weird, it's just for the vocals, rehydrating, really. Mm. So it's what kind of weird stuff were you thinking of? Like, you use Snickers or something?
Yeah,
or
like anything. If you got something funny, like pink toilet paper, who was it that
I guess pink toilet paper is basically... is basically something that bands have in the rider. In case something is not going to be based on the agreed to have it as a reason to cancel the gig.
Uh-huh.
It has been like that before. You broke the terms from the rider. You don't have that. So
I think it's something Van Halen started back in even the 70s, I think. He asked for M&Ms, I think it was, in just one color, just brown M&Ms. I don't remember the color, but if that's not backstage, something else is horribly wrong. So it's kind of, I think it's, well, in that sense, it might be just to make sure that everything is in order for the gig. But it's...
That's a good point. I hadn't thought about that.
Well, the thing is that for us, music is music, right? We're not going to agree doing a concert just because we need to satisfy other things around it, right?
Oh.
It's music, and I can perform the music. I even if there is minus two beers from the agreed amount of beers, so it's not. I never paid too much attention around it.
No. Okay. You talked about you have a new album coming out, or have you started to record the new album?
We actually recorded two new songs for a new EP that's going to be out in July, and right now we're writing music and lyrics for the new album that is gonna start being recorded in September and due to be released in December 2016.
Hmm. Okay. Do you got a title for it?
Nothing we can present at the moment. There are many things
that
are done, but it's not something that we can present right now.
But the EP you're releasing in July, you said, what is that entitled?
Well, this is going to be, it's an interesting concept because it's going to be the last re-release of El Merke, of the person. Mm-hmm. So I have decided that after being released in two different versions, and being sold out, this is gonna be the third time being re-released, and last we're never gonna agree printing anything after that. So it's gonna be an interesting packaging of 17-inch vinyl with two new songs, and on inside the same packaging there's gonna be a CD having the material of El Mercado de Person. So the whole release is being called Vintersalmer, and I say genom El Mercado de Person. So it's like marrying the old era with the new era and having everything under one title and under inside one package.
And that is Agonia Records gonna release?
This is something that is gonna be released by Soul Seller Records in from the Netherlands. Mm. But the new album is gonna be released by Agonia. Mm.
Great. Yeah, we can. Do you got some band recommendations? And then I'll think about like local bands, friends, small bands that people haven't heard of. Is it any bands you would like to promote?
Push forward.
Push forward. Sorry. Yeah.
For me in particular, because I'm one of the few that still buys music. Mm-hmm. I've been really impressed by two bands lately. One is In Culture, and the other one is Reptilian from Bergen. Mm-hmm. I think they're young and promising, and they present really good music. So thumbs up for that.
Mm. Cool. Do you got something?
I have one band that. It's kind of it's an interesting band because there are so many different backgrounds in the band. They're called Draug, and they're young and they're promising. And to be honest, I really like the thing they got going on, because they're playing black, but they're doing it. It's hard hitting. And it's still, you can still kind of just take a step back and just listen to the music. And so you can kind of connect to the music. I think they've released a 4-track EP now. Mm-hmm. At least listen to that on Spotify. And I think it's really good. So you should check that out if you have the time.
I will definitely check it out. Yeah, okay, great. And can you tell me now, like, what you kind of told me earlier, but the first album you really started to love, like you said AC/DC, Back in Black, earlier maybe, is it something you want to, more albums you can say?
That more albums.
Yeah.
For me, when it comes to black metal, it has always been top favorite album, Antichrist from Gorgoroth. For many different reasons, so that's milestone in a way for me.
Do you got a favorite black metal record?
It's not exactly black metal. I don't think you're such a fan of these records, but two records that really got me into into the genre, or into the more extreme music. It's two albums by Keep of Kalesin. It was upon those two albums that I founded with a friend, Jörn Andreas Dördal, my first band, Eon Throne. And it's Armada and Colossus by Keep of Kalesin. Musically, it's a little... it's not black metal in a sense. It is not black metal, but I really just enjoy it's the guitar works and the especially the vocals. My earliest vocals and my shouting technique is based a lot on that one. And there's a thrash band called Silosis. They're playing. I'm not a fan of where they've gone now, but they released a record in 2007 or 2009 called Conclusions of an Age, and it's one of the records that kind of stays with me. Then again, I'm seeking a lot of aggression as well, sort of. So I think those three records represent that, at least for me.
Thank you. What is the greatest wish or accomplishment or goal for the band Den Saakaldte? What is the highest thing you can achieve, if you can, whatever you want?
Be alive tomorrow.
Be alive tomorrow and make more.
It's do I want to make the band a profession? No.
No.
It wouldn't be the same for me. It's as I said, the band is like my personal shrink, right? So that I can be a better person for the people I care tomorrow. So that's how, that's why I make music. I never made music in order to chase a dollar. So no high hopes, no high expectations, no high goals. I just want to make music and record and make albums that maybe some other people would appreciate. And that's about it.
In that sense, it's maybe about just touching. If you're able to touch one person with your music or with your lyrics and kind of make them think, hey, you know what, this song is about me, or this song really gets me through this, or this song makes me see this, see the situation that I'm in, or maybe about enlightenment, or just, as I said, just being able to connect to the people through the music. It's not a goal, it's more of a state, if you will.
But then again, it's not in the sense that you make music for other people, right? First you make music for yourself. If some other people are gonna like it, that's great. But I was never in the sense that I would say, for example, to T-Bolt, you know, something, play the drums like that, because that's a bit, I don't know, trendy right now. People like this kind of tempos. This is music on demand, and we don't make music for, you know, by having a goal that other people are gonna like it.
No.
If other people are gonna like it, that's great, but it's not like we're gonna make it like that so that people do like it, if you see my point.
Do you got any last words? Anything you would like to say to the audience?
Be cruel to your school.
Be cruel to your school. That's a nice ending. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for being the first guest here in my studio 1430 apartment.
Cheers.
You're welcome.